Hello, hello, hello. Good afternoon and welcome to yet another SciFest Africa webinar. My name is Freddie Mashate and I am the manager of SciFest Africa and your host this afternoon. This session is obviously brought to you as part of the first ever virtual festival in 24 years. We do hope that you have been educated, inspired, and really have had a good time with us since we started this journey in October. If you've missed any of our offerings that we've had thus far, please do visit our website where you'll find all of them stored for you for your convenience and please do interact with them. This afternoon we have a session, Good Vibrations, the Science of Sound. It is a presentation that is created and presented by Dr. Derek Fish. Dr. Derek Fish is a science teacher by training, but has also studied and taught piano. If you are looking for someone that can teach you diverse types of instruments, he is definitely the person. He runs a science center. He has ran a science center for 30 years and is well known for his science show, which are presented to thousands of people annually. Derek has presented at science festivals in China, Poland, Slovenia and the UAE. He is passionate about awakening curiosity in children of all ages and showing that science and math are cool. During the session, please, if you do have any questions, please use the chat session section of Zoom. And if you're on Facebook, please do comment in the comment section. We will be monitoring the comments on that platform as well. Without further ado and without wasting any of your time, please let us give Derek a virtual round of applause as we hand over to him. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, that's fantastic. Thank you very much, Freddie, for that fantastic invitation to SciFest, and it's really great to be here. I trust that the sound's coming through well. So I've been doing a lot of Zoom talks over the last year of COVID, but this is the first Zoom science show. So I'm really excited about that. It's fantastic to be connecting with SciFest again. I've presented at many SciFest, not recently, but I presented this show about 15 years ago at SciFest, and it really is great to be here again. I really love questions. I love inquiring minds and curious children of all ages. So please do ask your questions. I'll just ask you to keep them or type them into the chat. It's going to be too difficult to juggle everything and keep an eye on the chat during the show. So please put them in the chat and we will deal with them at the end, I promise you. So let's go straight in. And I'm sure that all of you are familiar with South Africa's Got Talent. And I wonder, Ryan or Freddie, if you could just confirm that you are seeing my South Africa's Got Talent screen. Thank you.
Yes, perfect.
Excellent. Fantastic. Don't want to be talking about something that's not there. So a few years ago, I decided that I'd like to get onto South Africa's Got Talent. And I thought, well, you know, my great talent is, of course, playing the nose flute, which I'll show you guys a bit later. But this time I thought I'd try on the kazoo. Now, the only problem is to understand music, you actually need to know a little bit of science. And that's what I hope to teach you today. So I went in without too much practice and thought I would impress Simon Cowell by playing in the kazoo. So I got up on stage, took a deep breath, and needless to say, Simon was not impressed at all. I blew as hard as I could. This is a wind instrument. I got absolutely nothing. So he gave me a second chance. I thought maybe this is something you play like a trumpet by vibrating your lips. So I tried that one. Again, absolutely nothing from Simon. Now you see, the problem is one needs to understand sound, and sound all starts with a vibration. And you see, the problem with this kazoo is if there's no vibration, you don't get any sound at all. So to help you understand this, maybe you could all do an experiment with me. Now normally my audiences are very embarrassed about this experiment, but you're all in your homes and you've got no one to be embarrassed of except your family, and you guys are way past that with this year of COVID. So I'd like you to try this with me, please. Take two fingers, put them lightly on your throat, take a deep breath and sing. La! And you can see why I was never in the school choir. But if you tried that, I bet you felt something on your fingers. In fact, you should have felt some vibrations. I hope, in fact, that they were good vibrations. And you felt vibrations because in your throat you've got vocal cords, a little bit like guitar strings, and you vibrate those to talk and to sing. So with this kazoo, it's the same thing. If you blow a smooth airflow, there's no vibrations. So the way you play the kazoo is not to blow into it, but to hum into it like this. And then it sounds like this. And in fact, Simon was so impressed that I played South Africa's national anthem for him. But before I disgrace our country any further, let's rather move on. And ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Good Vibrations.
I love the colorful clothes you wear and the way the sunlight plays.
Now, I hope you know that song, the Beach Boys song, Good Vibration, was a great hit in 1965, the year that I was born. And it talks about the fact that if we're going to have music, we're going to need some vibrations. And in fact, when you look at a musical instrument, you can ask the question, what is vibrating? So let's have a look at a couple of things. And I'm just going to put my camera up so that hopefully you can see these a bit more clearly. So I've just got a simple old balloon here. I'm going to blow it up. Now, if I hold the neck and let the air come out, as the air rushes past, it causes the neck to vibrate and we get that sound. Now, sometimes vibrations are quite strange. So I've got an aluminium bar here. It's a solid aluminium bar. And if I take it and I hit it, it vibrates and you can hear that sound. But let's try to make it vibrate in a different way. When I hit it, it actually causes transverse waves to run through it. I'll explain those in a moment. But I want to make some longitudinal waves by actually taking this bar and stretching it. Now the problem here is that I don't have a good enough grip to stretch the bar. So I'm going to take some of this. This is what we call rosin. And anyone who plays a string instrument like a cello or a violin knows it. It's a kind of a wax. And normally this is applied to the strings of your bow for your violin or cello to make those strings slightly sticky so that they can grip the strings of the violin. Now I'm putting it on my aluminium bar. I'm also rubbing it on my fingers and hopefully that'll give me enough grip to actually make my bar sing. Let's try. It's a little bit sticky here in Zulu land, so let me try put a little bit more on because we need to really grip this bar. Here we go. And I'm sure you can hear that by now. I bet you didn't know that an aluminium bar can sing like that. And I'm literally stretching the bar and it snaps back into place. Sound travels through the air at about 330 meters per second. It travels through aluminium, solid aluminium, at about 5 kilometers per second. And as the sound waves race through that aluminium bar, they make that singing sound just like that. So we need a vibration, and every musical instrument doesn't play itself. You have to pluck the strings of a guitar, you have to beat a drum. And so we can basically divide up musical instruments into five different types. We have vibrating solids, like the bar you've just seen. We have vibrating skins or membranes, like in a drum. We have vibrating strings or cords, like in a violin or a guitar. We have vibrating air mass, like when I speak or when I sing or play the kazoo. And finally, vibrating electronic circuits, like in a cell phone or a keyboard. So I just want to teach you a little bit about waves, which will really help you understand. And if you ever end up on South Africa's Got Talent, hopefully you'll do a much better job than I did. So just bear with me a little bit while I go through a little bit of this theory. So we have two types of waves. We call them transverse and longitudinal. Now, light and radio and x-rays are transverse waves, but we want to look at the bottom type, sound waves, which are pressure waves. Now, we can show this with a slinky, but it's a bit difficult over Zoom. So let me rather show you a great simulation. So at the top here, you can see a transverse wave. You can see the wave is traveling from left to right. At the bottom, the particles have a longitudinal wave passing through them. Now, try to focus on just one particle in the transverse wave. And you can see that the particle is just going up and down. Every particle is doing that, but the wave is moving from left to right. At the bottom, if we focus on one particle, Each particle is just going left and right. So it's called transverse because the movement is trans or across the direction of the wave. Longitudinal, the movement is along the direction of the wave. Now, when a loudspeaker plays, the sound waves spread out almost like ripples on a pond. Except, of course, a pond is two-dimensional circles, but with a speaker, they spread out almost like a growing ball of sound going away like that. So the problem is we can't see sound waves, so it's difficult to understand them. But using some great technology, I'm going to enable you to see some sound waves today. We're going to go to this program called Data Studio. It's made by Pasco Scientific, and it really is a great program. And you can see that as I'm talking, the sound wave at the top is moving up and down. What we've got at the bottom is what we call a frequency spectrum. So we've got low frequency on the left and high frequency on the right. Now the frequency is how many vibrations there are per second. So if I do this with my hand, that's a slow frequency. And if I go really fast, that's a higher frequency. So the sounds on the left, if for example I beat a drum like this, you can see all the peaks are going up mostly on the left hand side. But if I take these tiny little cymbals and play them next to my microphone, you can see we're getting some really high peaks, up to about 8,000 vibrations per second. So let me teach you a couple of things about sound waves which are important to know. If I keep quiet, can you see that the sound wave is very small? But if I speak loudly, you can see the sound wave becomes really tall because the height of the wave has to do with volume, with how loud something is. Second thing is the width of the wave has to do with pitch. Now, when I talk about pitch, I mean high or low. So let's take this instrument. This is an interesting type of flute, and you can see I can make it long. I can make it longer or shorter like this. I want you to watch more closely now and look at the width of the wave at the top, not the height. Watch how the width changes as the pitch rises. And you should be able to see those waves getting a little bit more squashed up. Let me change the scale a little bit. Let's try that again. And I think you could see the wave squashing up as the pitch went higher and now stretching out as the pitch went lower. Now, one other important thing is, children, I'm sure that you and your parents do not agree on what constitutes music and what constitutes noise. Usually you put your music on and your mom says, turn off that noise. Well, there's a very clear scientific definition. Let's start off with some noise. I've got an instrument here which I got from Colombia. It looks like a cheese grater and it plays like this. That's pretty much noise, isn't it? And watch the wave at the top when I play it. It has no clear shape at all. And at the bottom, you can see every single frequency is selected. So when we have noise, there's no clear shape to the wave and every frequency is selected. When we have music, it's different. Now, probably the purest form of music I can make is simply by whistling. So let me try to whistle a note. Now, what you see at the top is you see a very nice repetitive wave. It's not perfectly smooth. You can see my volume was changing a bit, but it's a smooth repetitive waveform. At the bottom, you can see it's really just one main frequency which is selected there. So music has a smooth, repetitive waveform. Remember, noise was just a mess. Now, different instruments have got different patterns. So if I pick up, for example, a recorder here you should be familiar with. Let's switch on our microphone again and play a note. If I freeze that, you can see at the top, it's not smooth, but it is repetitive. And this recorder has a distinctive shape to it. What you can see at the bottom, which is interesting, is you've got a main note and then you've got various different harmonics which are picking up. And what we'll talk about a bit later is every instrument has its own distinctive wave shape, which makes that instrument interesting. Some instruments are more noisy than others. For example, look at the kazoo I played just now. You can see that that's really more noise than actually music. Now, let me go to my sound creator here. And if I switch on the loudspeaker, so you can hear a note which is being played by the loudspeaker. And if I make the wave smaller, I want you to notice how the note changes. So the height of the wave has to do with the volume or the loudness. If I make the wave wider, you can hear the pitch goes lower. If I make the wave narrower, it goes higher and higher and higher and higher. I'm sure it's really irritating, you know, and even higher. Now, I actually can't hear the sound anymore, but I'm sure the young people who are listening can hear the sound. This is probably about 15,000 vibrations a second. I think the young people will know that I'm turning it off now, and that sound has actually gone. So I hope that helped you to see some waves as they're represented on the computer and just understand a little bit more about sound waves. So just to summarize, when we represent a wave, remember, this is just a representation for the computer. The height of the wave has to do with volume, and the width has to do with pitch. So a sound which is loud is a very tall wave. A sound which is soft is a flat wave. Now, you know, if you're in the ocean, if you see a big tall wave coming towards you, you run away. If you see a small wave, you're not so worried. So the height of a wave has to do with the amount of energy in it. Also, when we come to pitch, if the sound is high, like a soprano singing, the wave is all squashed up. And if the sound is low, like a bass singing, then the sound is all stretched out. We also talked about the fact that music has a nice, smooth, familiar wave shape, whereas noise is just all messed up like that. Now, remember that really high tone which I played you, about 15,000 hertz. What happens is when you get beyond about 28, your eardrums can't vibrate fast enough and you just can't hear it. I can't hear that. So children, if you could hear that, go onto the internet and look up mosquito ringtones. Now, this is a ringtone for your cell phone that's at about 15,000 hertz. So you can hear it, your friends can hear it, but your teacher can't hear it. So you can send messages to each other in class, your phones will be ringing, but the teacher can't hear it. Make sure it's not a young teacher, otherwise they will be able to hear it. But grown-ups, if you think this is unfair, don't worry. Grown-ups got their revenge as well. Someone in England invented something called the mosquito. Now, shopkeepers had been bothered by young people hanging around their shops and actually scaring away customers. So he puts up a loudspeaker that plays a sound which is very high, about 16,000 vibrations a second, and also very loud. The teenagers can't bear it and they run away. The adults can't hear it and they go shopping. So this is a selective teenage repellent. Isn't that a fantastic idea? Right, so that's the theory. Let's get on to the musical instruments themselves. So let's start off with solid bodies which are vibrating. And these are often called percussion or concussion instruments because they hit together and shaken. And you get some which are just there to provide some rhythm and others which actually can play a tune as well. Now, let's have a look at some of those a little bit more closely. And I'm going to go across to my camera at this stage. So, for example, I've got a beautiful wooden frog here, and this has been very carefully carved so that it croaks like a frog. Just listen to it. And these ridges on the back are just the right intervals so that the solid block of wood vibrates at just the right time to make it croak like a frog. Now, of course, people have enjoyed using shakers for percussion for a long time. Here in Zululand, we have lots of zebras, and this one's shaped like a zebra. I got this one from Kenya. It took me a while to work out why it wasn't working till I realized that you have to put a little bit of a twist into it if you want it to work. And various bells and other things from different parts of the world. This one is quite interesting. It's a wooden block for percussion. And if you listen, I think you can hear two distinct notes. Now, the reason for that is clear if I turn it around, because you can see it's hollow in the middle. And if I hit here or here, we get different notes. Now, you might have used this if you've laid some tiles on the floor or the wall, and you can hit them. If they sound like that, they're fine. If they sound like that, it means that there's a hollow space underneath. I've suggested possibly, particularly in COVID times, we could save a lot of money by not having exams. Just give teachers a little hammer like this. And if you hit pupils on the head, if you hear something like that, they've probably got something inside. If you hear something like that, there's nothing inside. They should probably repeat the year. Just kidding. All of these things are great fun, but the problem is that they only play one note. So if we want to play different notes, we need to make different lengths. So you can see this African marimba, also often called a xylophone or a glockenspiel. And you can see that the bits of wood are different lengths. And that enables us to play a tune on here. Now you see the long ones give low notes and the short ones give high notes. So it's very easy to remember. Long is low and short is high. So we can play a simple tune. So I hope you recognize happy birthday to you. And there's a very important mathematical relationship between the lengths of these. Now, perhaps the easiest way to look at that would be with a set of boom whackers. Now, this is what boom whackers look like. They're simply hollow plastic tubes, and you can see they're all different lengths here. And those different lengths correspond to different musical notes. So let's take these apart here, and I'll try to arrange them in front of me here. Okay, so let me get rid of some. So we've got the note C, which is the longest, and then we've got a D, and then an E, and then an F. Oops. And if I turn them sideways, put them all together, I think you can see the different length there. Now I'm going to hand E and F to my trusty assistant. And we needed a hollow object to make resonance, and she suggested my head would do. So we're going to try to play South Africa's national anthem on my head with boom whackers. So here we go. Oh, and we've already started the wrong way. I started with the wrong hand. Let's start again. South Africa's national anthem. Okay, and a big hand for my trusty assistant. Thanks very much, Jess. But the important thing there is the length. As you change the length, the pitch actually changes. And in fact, that's true for almost every instrument. When you play an instrument, in some ways, you're simply changing the length. Here's another beautiful African instrument, often called an imbira. This particular one is a kalimba. And you can see the long pieces of metal, the low notes and the short one play the high notes. So this thumb piano makes these beautiful sounds. Now the design of musical instruments is very important. And in fact, if you have a look at this, you can see it's got a wooden box with a hole in the middle. Now you'll have noticed the same design in something like a guitar. And you might wonder, why is that important? Because electric guitars don't have it. Well, it's part of the amplification system. And this instrument would sound a lot quieter if it didn't have this. Now let me show you just how effectively this works. So I've got a tiny little music box here. I'll hold it up to the camera. You can see, and if I wind the handle, it can play a little tune for us. Now I'm going to just hold it in front of me. You can see here my microphone is, and let's just see how loud it sounds. I hope you can hear that, but it's very quiet. Now all I'm going to do, no cheating, is I'm simply going to hold it on the wood of this box. So this instrument's not doing anything. We're just using this wooden box as a sounding board, and let's listen to it now. So you can see what a difference that actually makes compared with if we just use this music box by itself. Now, I wonder if you've seen something like this before. A jewelry box but the ballerina that pops up and spins around and plays a little tune. Well, a jewelry box like this has a little music box like this inside. But I wondered if you realized how important it was that the box is made of wood, because it uses that box for resonance to make the sound of that tiny little music box so much louder. So it's very important how musical instruments are actually designed. Okay, so we've been talking a lot about vibrating solids, and I've shown you a few different things that you can do with them. Do you know that you can make a marimba out of bottles of water just by filling them with different amounts of water? If you strike the bottles gently with a wooden stick, you'll get a musical scale from left to right, and the longest water column will give you the lowest note, and the shortest water column will give you the highest note. If you blow over the tops of the bottles, you'll get a musical scale in the opposite direction, because there's the length of the air column which actually makes a difference. Now, you can actually play a whole tune by filling bottles with different amounts of water. And I want to show you a guy who went to one of the streets of New York and filled up 362 wine bottles with different amounts of water, placed them at different intervals, and then skated through the middle on rollerblades. Now, his rollerblades have got a little drumstick like this on the side of them. So have a look at what he did. It's really quite fun. I think you'll agree that he deserves a hand for that. So you understand that the spacing of the bottles determined the rhythm, and the amount of water in the bottles determined the pitch, how high or how low each note was. So we've talked about vibrating solid objects. Let's move on to vibrating skins and listen to some drums from around the world. So there you heard different drum sounds, and the size of a drum, the tightness of the skin and so on tells us how it's going to sound. Now, you can't actually play tunes on drums. It's impossible to tune the drum skin, but you can make characteristic sounds. A snare drum like this one has snares or springs which are actually strung underneath it. Now, let's have a look at my camera again. And let me show you a few drums. This is a rattle drum, which actually comes from Brazil. And of course, once again, like my Kenyan rattle, you need to spin that and we get that characteristic sound, which is such fun. Now, quite often drum skins are actually used for amplification. And I picked up this little instrument, which I believe comes from Thailand. Now, it's just a wooden stick with some fishing line. And then this frog has got a little drum head there, which amplifies the sound, so you can hear our frog croaking. And of course, you can also play it like that by spinning it around. Now, what you're actually hearing is you're hearing the string rubbing on the wood there, but without the drumstick it sounds very quiet, but with the drumstick it amplifies that so you can hear it. Now, I came across a similar type of instrument. This is a sitar from India. It's just got a single string, and you can see at the bottom there's a drum skin. So again, the string would sound very quiet without that drum skin to actually make the sound louder. Here's a thunder stick, and again there's a drum skin at the bottom and the spring, and if I shake it near the microphone, hopefully you can hear the sounds of a thunderstorm brewing. So it's interesting that around the world this idea of using a drum skin to make things louder has actually been used. Okay, let's move on to vibrating strings. So we've had solids, we've had skins, and now we move on to strings. Now, of course, guitars are very well-known instruments, and again they sound different depending on how they are made. So an acoustic guitar sounds like this. An electric guitar like this. And you'll notice the electric guitar doesn't have the sound box with the hole in, and it's amplified electrically. Now listen to a bass guitar. Now that sounds really deep. And I told you earlier that long is low and short is high. So maybe you're thinking that men have deeper voices than ladies because they're taller. But that's not really the case. And in fact, the bass guitar tells us why men have deeper voices than ladies. You can see it's about the same size as the other guitars. Now, there are three things which change the pitch on a guitar string. One is how tight the string is, and that you change by turning those keys. The other thing is how long the string is, and you change that by putting your fingers on the fingerboard. But the third thing is how thick the string is. And you can see a bass guitar has very thick strings. They're overwound with copper to make them heavier, to vibrate more slowly. And in fact, this tells us why men have deeper voices than ladies. And here's an interesting graph which shows how voice changes with age. Now, maybe you're a bit scared of graphs, but this one's very easy to understand. On the bottom, you've got your age from birth up till age 90. On the vertical axis, you've got the frequency or the pitch. So this is high and this is low. And don't worry too much about the numbers, which won't be familiar to you, but I've put a piano keyboard on the side for reference. About 260 vibrations a second is about middle C on a piano. Now babies, as we know from a baby's cry, are born with very high voices. As children reach puberty, the voices obviously go lower, but boys' voices go much lower than girls' voices do. Female voices average out, of course it's an average, at about 220 vibrations a second, and male voices at about 130 vibrations per second. And they pretty much stay that way from puberty till the end of the life, with the exception that old men get slightly squeaky voices as their vocal cords get a little bit stiff. Now what happens is, just like with the bass guitar, when a boy becomes a man, his vocal cords get a little bit thicker and a little bit looser and a little bit longer. They vibrate more slowly and they get that characteristic deep voice. Now, unfortunately for boys, this doesn't happen overnight. It would be wonderful if they went to sleep and said, "Good night, mommy," and woke up the next morning and said, "Hello, father." But unfortunately, for a few weeks, their voice goes up and down, which can be very embarrassing. So please be nice to young boys whose voices are breaking. Now, of course, the size of a guitar is important. I just wanted to show you this. This is apparently the biggest guitar in the world. It might be easier for you to see that if I put myself in the picture. This is not trick photography. This is at the Deutsches Museum in Germany. The guitar is so big that you can play it from the inside, which is pretty cool. Now think for a minute, how would this guitar sound? Very high or very low? And of course, because it's so long, it would sound very low. In fact, it doesn't sound nice at all. And since then, I've found other big guitars. This is in Seattle Science Center, Pacific Science Center in Seattle. And I found this huge guitar in Ethiopia. So you get lots of different string instruments. You get beautiful harps and lyres. You get instruments you pluck with your fingers or with picks, and instruments that are played with bows. Now these are the string instruments from an orchestra. And I want to just show you again how this long is low and short is high works. The violin has the shortest strings and sounds like this. Viola is a bit longer. Cello even longer. It's really long. So it's really simple. The longer the instrument gets, the deeper the sound goes. Now, the most popular string instrument of all is the instrument actually which I learned, I haven't mentioned so far. And of course, that is. And in the piano, you have strings which are hit by hammers. And again, the thickness, the tension, and the length of those strings is varied. Let's move on to my favorite type of instruments, where you have vibrating air. Now, here you see five wind instruments, and I want you to listen to them as they are played from left to right. sure you notice that each instrument has its own characteristic sound, and we call that the timbre or the tone color of the instrument. If you had a look at the graphs of the sound wave of a flute, oboe, and clarinet, even though they're playing the same note, the graphs are different. How do we know they're playing the same note? Because the width between the peaks or the wavelength is the same. And the reason that the sound wave graphs are different is because of the way the vibration is produced. And in a flute, it's a vibration over an open hole. In an oboe, it's a reed instrument. An oboe has a double reed, a clarinet, a single reed. And so because of those differences, you get different sounds, which is great, because the orchestra would sound very boring if all the instruments sounded exactly the same. So we get three types of wind instruments, and I'd like to take you through those quickly. So first of all, you have the flute family, where the vibration happens. It's almost like blowing over the top of a bottle. The vibration happens as the air vibrates over an open hole. That includes recorders. And I really want to encourage everyone listening, don't just listen to music, go out and learn an instrument. And a recorder is both easy to learn and it's very cheap. You can get one for under 100 Rand, because I know some instruments can be really expensive. Now I want to show you a few flutes, and anthropologists found a tribe in the Amazon that played a flute by sticking it up their nose. I wonder what that looks like. Let's go across to my camera. So first of all, I've got a piston flute, which I showed you earlier, and I can change the length like a trombone by pulling this piston in and out, and it sounds like this. So I can try to play a tune on this. That wasn't very good, was it? Because it's really difficult to know exactly where to stop, and that's why some instruments like the trombone are so hard to play. So to make life easier, in something like a recorder, the holes have been drilled at exactly the right place, so it's really easy to play. I think you'll all agree that sounded a bit better. You use your fingers to cover the holes, and you're effectively just making the tube longer or shorter. The one hole you should never cover is this one here. It has the strange name of the fipple, because then you sound like me on South Africa's Got Talent. That's where the vibration is produced. Now there's various variations on a recorder. This is a Chinese instrument called an ocarina. It's a bit like a sideways recorder, and it sounds pretty much the same. Again, using the same principle. So I promised to show you an instrument which is played with the nose. So this is my nose flute. Not an instrument you share with friends, because you have to blow your nose through it. And you blow your nose through the top part, and you use your lips to make shapes on the bottom part, like this. I can hear the thunderous applause already. And if you practice hard, you too can learn to play the nose flute. So let's have a look at the next class of instruments, which are what we call reed instruments. But before we get to reed instruments, maybe you think you don't have what it takes to get onto South Africa's Got Talent. I want to tell you, this guy got to the semi-finals of Arabs Got Talent using just a drinking straw. Have a look at what he did.
أهلا وسهلا شو الاسم الكريم؟
حسن ميناوي
شو موهبتك؟
العزف على المصاصة
وقدي صارك بتعملها هيدي؟
من 2008 تقريبا
انت مجوز عندك أولاد؟
نعم عندي بنتين
بينبسطوا بهالقصة اللي
طبعا
عمتنيا.
طبعا ايه؟ طبعا
خلينا نشوف
So I'm sure you agree that's pretty impressive for a drinking straw. So all these instruments featured here have got reeds inside, which are really just something like a drinking straw, normally made of bamboo, that vibrates in your mouth, and they sound like the saxophone, the oboe, clarinet, and the one we love to hate, the bagpipes. So let me show you how to make an oboe out of a drinking straw. Again, let's go to my camera so you can see it more clearly. So all you need is a drinking straw, and the straws from McDonald's work the best. So children, encourage your parents to take you to McDonald's to do scientific research. Take the straw, flatten it at the end, take a pair of scissors and just cut the end to a point. And I'll just try to, not doing a very good job on the screen here, sorry. I'll try to hold that close to you so you can see there. So you can see I've cut it to a point like a spear. So I've got two little reeds which can vibrate in my mouth. If I blow from this end, I get nothing. But from this end, you can hear I get a great sound. If it's not loud enough, you can borrow a vuvuzela. To get a little bit more volume there. Now, what he'd done on Arab's Got Talent is made lots of holes here. And what I'm going to do is just show you what a difference the length of the straw makes. So I want you to try to think ahead of time. I'm going to take some scissors and I'm going to cut the straw shorter as I'm playing it. And I'd like you to think about what's going to happen to the sound as the straw gets shorter. And you can hear, of course, that as the straw gets shorter, the pitch changes and gets higher. So what we've learned definitely does work. So that's how you can get yourselves onto Arab's Got Talent. And then just mention a couple of other instruments which use reeds inside. In fact, the harmonica and the accordion have both got a little reed, just like a drinking straw, of different lengths inside, which make the different sounds. So I mentioned to you the vuvuzela, and these instruments are really interesting, and I just want to show you, I actually made myself a bugle out of a hosepipe. This is just a common or garden hosepipe with a kitchen funnel. It's got a proper bugle mouthpiece. Again, if you blow it, you get nothing out, but if I go into it, we get quite a nice bugle sound out of it. The bugle is actually nothing more than really just a hose pipe, something like that. I want to show you one more instrument, and this is the whirly pipe. You can see it's just a plastic pipe. It's got these ridges in it, and when I swing the pipe, the ridges cause the air in it to start vibrating. So let me swing this around. Hopefully you'll be able to hear. If you listen carefully, you can actually hear five different notes which come out of that pipe. So what's happening here is when we swing it slowly, we get a high pressure in the middle of the pipe and low pressures at the end. And as we swing it faster, it squashes up those waves inside. And that's what makes the pitch go higher. And if you're at all musical and were listening to those notes, you should have been able to hear that they actually play the notes of major scale. Sorry, of a major chord. Let me try it one more time. You can listen again. Okay, so that is the whirly pipe. So we've looked at vibrating solids, vibrating strings, vibrating skins, vibrating air. The last is really the least interesting, vibrating electronic circuits, because it's very hard to explain or understand. Keyboards and cell phones use vibrating electronics to make things happen. Let me just jump ahead. Because of time, it's important to understand what goes on inside our ears. And so this thing over here is actually really important, and it's also very delicate. And the three smallest bones in the human body, the hammer, anvil, and stirrup, are right here down your auditory canal. And this very delicate eardrum, so that as vibrating sound waves go in here, they make the eardrum vibrate, and that passes the sound through the cochlea and into your brain. Now, different animals can hear different ranges of sound. Humans can typically hear from 20 vibrations a second, or 20 hertz. up to 20,000. There's a piano keyboard for comparison, which goes from about 40 to 4,000 hertz. Bats can hear up to 200,000 vibrations a second. They use it to echolocate. Bats are blind, but they have a kind of a radar system bouncing sound waves off. Dolphins can hear up to 250,000 vibrations a second. Dogs can hear up to about 80,000 compared with our 20,000, which is why you get ultrasonic dog whistles. Finally, look at mosquitoes. They can only hear this very narrow little band of sound, which corresponds to this. So if a mosquito irritates you, can you imagine how much he irritates himself? Now I want to finish off with a bang tonight, and I mentioned the harmonica and the accordion, which are both what we call free reed instruments. That inside there are lots of these little straws which vibrate and are cut to different lengths. So I'd like to go across to my camera now, and I've got these two instruments here. In fact, so here's my piano accordion. In Afrikaans, there is a trekker or a pompkas. They have a wonderful name for it in isiZulu. In isiZulu, they call it isiVula Vala Dlala Bala, which literally means open, close, and play for free. Then I also have a harmonica here. And harmonica is quite tricky to play because when you blow and suck, you actually get two different sounds. So you've got to remember when to blow and when to suck. So I'm going to try to finish off by playing our South African national anthem simultaneously on these two free reed instruments, the harmonica and the mouth organ. Don't try this at home. That's all from me, folks. I hope that you've enjoyed the show. I hope you've learned a little bit more about sound and about waves. And I hope you've got some questions to give me now. Thank you very much. And over to you, Freddie, for some questions.
Thank you so very much, Derek. That was really exciting and inspiring. I've learned a lot. Thank you, thank you, thank you. There's a question here from Lay, and it says that, where can I find the pipes that you're playing on your head?
Okay. So you'll have to use your own head, but they're known as boom whackers. And I have, you know, unfortunately, most of these really fun instruments I showed you, I've picked up from different places around the world. And they're really not that easy to find. But these are known as boom whackers, B-O-O-M. And if you just Google that. Otherwise, though, it will work with any plastic pipes. It'll even work with something like mailing tubes. And you can just cut them to different lengths. And as you cut them to those different lengths, you will get different notes out of them. Okay.
Interesting. Just to say to the audience, if you do have a question, please do feel free to raise your hand and ask the question live. So Derek, this is just a personal question of mine. We've always heard that, you know, sound travels faster underwater. Why is such?
Okay, that's a good question. So a lot of people have the misconception that you have to have air for sound to travel. Now, of course, you have to have a medium for sound to travel, which is why sound does not travel through space, because there's a vacuum. But in fact, sound travels very slowly through air. So I told you it travels about 330 meters per second, depending on temperature and humidity. That's about 1,300 kilometers per hour. Now, the problem is, remember, sound is a vibration that passes through a medium. And in a gas, the particles are very far apart. So the sound is not transferred from one particle to the other very efficiently. In water, the sounds are much closer, sorry, the particles are much closer together. So sound goes about three times as fast in water. And in solids, as I said, like this aluminium bar, which I showed you earlier, sound travels up to 5 kilometers per second. So when you see people putting their ear on a railway track to listen if a train is coming, actually, that's true. You could hear a train very far away. So we had a question on the Q&A, I see. which said, can fish hear us? Which is a very good question. Okay, so fish's eyes and ears are designed to pick up light and sound waves through water. So very little of the sound that's above the water will get through to under the water. And in fact, you'll notice if you go underwater, things often become quiet. But you'll also notice if you're underwater and you knock two stones together or something, it sounds really loud. So fish certainly can hear other sounds underwater. And in fact, whales famously are able to communicate with each other up to 5 kilometers apart by using a mixture of infrasound, very low pitch sound, and ultrasound, very high pitch sound. So certainly fish of various sort can hear underwater. But usually they don't hunt in that way. For example, sharks are much more likely to use their sense of smell than to use their sense of hearing to hunt prey.
Very interesting. Just a reminder, Derek, for those that are hearing an echo, that's because Derek has two mics, which were set to do the job when we were, throughout the session. But there's a question coming in here from Donnie. It says, does sound travel slower in an echo?
Okay, thanks, Donnie, and thanks for tuning in. Very good question. So no, sound doesn't travel slower in an echo, but what happens with an echo is sound travels away from you and it bounces back off a solid surface. So you've probably experienced echoes in a mountainous region. And for example, if you clap your hands, that squeezes the air, that compression travels away from your hands at 340 meters per second. And what happens is it hits a vertical rock face and it bounces back and you hear it. Now, just think, 340 meters per second means 3 seconds to travel a kilometer. So if that rock face is maybe is a kilometer away, it'll be a full 2 seconds before the sound actually comes back to you. Sorry, it'll be 6 seconds before the sound comes back to you. So it seems like the sound is traveling slow. It's not traveling more slowly. What is happening is that it's actually just taking time to get back to you. Now, you see the slow speed of sound when you watch a lightning storm. Light travels a million times faster than sound. So when there's a lightning bolt, the light and the sound are produced at exactly the same time. But the light travels to you instantly at 300 million meters per second, but the sound takes time to travel to you. So you often notice during a lightning storm, you will see the lightning flash, but you'll only hear it a bit later. Freddie, I'm just going to continue. I'm seeing some other questions in the chat, and it's easier with the microphones. So Kieran, the question is, what vibrates in a recorder? And again, it's a fantastic question. I've got a recorder in front of me. And remember, recorders are part of the flute family. And the flute family works by air vibrating as it escapes through a hole. Now, you can see this hole at the top is called the fipple. Now, if I blow the recorder, there's vibration. If I cover the fipple, we get absolutely nothing at all. So what happens is as I blow, about half the air escapes out of the fipple and the other half goes down the tube. And the disturbance between that air splitting like that causes the vibration. Even in the nose flute that I have here, there's something like a fipple at the top of it, which actually causes that vibration and which also mustn't be covered. So great question. I see that Ikona is asking, why do oboe players have to lick their reeds before playing? Great question. I don't know the answer for certain, but I imagine it's to make the reeds flexible. So the reeds are made of bamboo, and obviously if they're too stiff, they're not going to vibrate properly. So I imagine it's to make the reeds flexible. And because an oboe has two reeds, perhaps it's to make sure that if you need to squeeze the reeds together, it makes a good air seal between them. But great question. Thanks very much, Ikona. Okay, Freddie, over to you again.
Yeah, maybe one last question from me. I'm just interested. I've been following and you've been, doing a lot of webinars on space. And apparently there's no sound in space. I don't know how true is this, but why is so?
Okay, again, great question. So it often confuses people that light travels through space, but sound doesn't. Now, light is an electromagnetic wave. Let me start there. So it's vibrating electrical and magnetic fields, and they don't need a medium to travel through. So they can travel through a vacuum. And for example, the best example of electromagnetic waves we have is just sunlight. And sunlight reaches us, and it gives us all the beautiful colors that we see. It has infrared rays, which make us feel warm, ultraviolet rays, which give us sunburn, and so on. Similarly, radio waves travel from stars and so on. So because it doesn't need a medium and it's just electric and magnetic fields, it can travel through space. Sound, on the other hand, is a pressure wave and it needs to travel through a medium. Now that can be solid, liquid, or gas, but it cannot be a vacuum. And sound cannot travel through a vacuum. Now the Earth is surrounded by an atmosphere which goes up with different density up to about 100 kilometers, but beyond that, space is essentially a vacuum. The moon has no atmosphere, so sound would not be transmitted. So when astronauts talk to each other, of course, their heads are covered with helmets, but they have to use radios to be able to communicate to each other. So sound needs a medium to travel, light or radio waves do not. Thanks.
Great. Another question coming from Donne. Does plastic amplify sound like wood?
Okay, Donne, another great question. Yes. Now, the amount of amplification depends on the shape of something. So let me grab my little music box again. And I think you heard before how quiet it is. You can barely hear it, but if I even just put it down on my desk, which you can't see, but I think you can hear that it's a lot louder. And what's happening here, these little bits of metal are so tiny that they move a very small amount of air, and so the sound is quiet. As soon as I put it down on something wooden, like for example this box here, suddenly the whole wooden box can vibrate, and it's a much larger vibrating surface. So that would also work for something plastic. I'm kind of trying to see if I could get, okay, so here I've got a tray which is made of plastic. Let's do an experiment in front of you. Put it on the tray and you can see it also makes it louder. So yes, indeed, plastic amplifies like wood. Of course, Stradivarius violins are famous and expensive because they're made out of a really special wood, and their shape and thickness and everything are just right to provide optimal amplification of the violin strings. Thank you.
Derek, you've already obviously traveled around the world. I'm just keen to know, have you kept count of the amount of instruments that you've come across?
That's a great question, and I honestly haven't. But Freddie, what I find really interesting is that you have the same ideas in different parts of the world. And you know, music is something which just goes right across all cultures and all countries. And it's been really fascinating doing this music show, for example, in China and in Arab countries and in Europe, and finding that although people have different instruments, those five categories I mentioned to you, vibrating solids, strings, skins, air, and electronics, pretty much encompass all the different instruments. And basic principles like long is low and short is high, the basic physics behind all the instruments is the same, and it doesn't really matter where you are or what the instruments look like. What is also fantastic is that music is something which is not owned by Hollywood or by anyone else. We have fantastic music and dancing here in Zululand, and in different parts of the world similarly so. So it's been really interesting to see the link between the arts and science with music. And I love being able to be part of both worlds. And again, I really want to encourage children particularly, learn a musical instrument. Start with this recorder. It's cheap, it's easy, and that'll give you the basics, which will allow you easily to branch out into piano, accordion, guitar, and other things later. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Derek. We will certainly be going to McDonald's for, you know, science experiments. Thank you for that tip. And, you know, we've learned a lot. I personally have learned a lot about music and vibrations. And really, thank you for offering your time and the knowledge and the experience on this platform. Thank you. I see we do not have any other questions. I'll just take this opportunity to just announce that we do have a webinar, as I'd said earlier, that is coming on at 6, and this webinar will be basically exploring the intersections between art and science, and you know, looking at you know better ways of communicating science using art, and how we can modify and create new ways of you know learning and understanding. On Friday, all the kids are invited to come back onto this platform. We have a workshop that is part of the Discover workshops. We started these on the 8th of January, and those of you that have been with us, you would know that they're exciting and inspiring. Please do join us for that as well. You can find all details on our website, and I should say that our website is being updated on a weekly basis. So yeah, please do visit it regularly to see what's on. Thank you to you, the audience that, you know, graced us, you know, without you, we would not have a show. It would be just, you know, me and Derek, and it would be really awkward. But thank you for, you know, following. We hope that, you know, this platform has inspired you, and that you continue to learn, and that, you know, that you're finding it, you know, worth your time. Allow me to thank Derek again and the UniZulu Science and Technology Center for offering their time and space. And from us here at SciFest Africa, and from Derek, thank you, and good night.
Thank you, everybody, and goodbye.